here, on a cloud in a box.
I had that for a long time now.
Well, man, you really know how to sulk, don't you?
I'm not sulking.
You live in a box.
That's no more a box than you are a governess.
Oh, spoken like a man. You know what I'm saying? It's all the best. Sweet little Clara works with Rose and Crown ideas about their sexual world. For your information, I'm not sweet on the inside, and I'm certainly not...
Cold.
Okay.
So, first of all, the context of the situation is that the doctor is grieving. He's quite depressed, to be honest. And he's kind of given up at being his enthusiastic character. And this is the moment where he comes back. He decides to be the doctor again after however long he's been grieving for. So, mise en scène. The TARDIS kind of, it reflects the doctor. Through the whole sequence, it reflects what the doctor is at that point. So the outer shell is him worn down. The TARDIS is normally this gleaming box, but you can tell he's old just simply from the TARDIS, because the TARDIS is always with him. But then, also the darkness of the TARDIS when you first go in, he's quite shut down. He's not really himself. Then, of course, when the lights go on, he's waking up again. It's almost like the Doctor is rebooting. It reflects his attitude. It's a dark TARDIS now. It's sort of the attitude. When he turns on the lights. Yeah, so the lights reflect how sudden the Doctor is, because every single time he enters a situation, especially Matt Smith's Doctor, he likes to make a big entrance and shock people. And that's the lights blur on at first, and then get used to it a little bit more. The lights of the centre unit was quite clever. I don't know whether I'm right, but the blue centre unit was, to me, it was the centre of his depression, and it didn't shine any light on the rest of the room, so the room was completely dark. And then when the doctor walked towards it, it faded to green, almost as if his depression lifted. And then that, once he lifted up the lights, that spread to the rest of the room. So it's this change of heart. It's almost as if the TARDIS is waiting for him, because he's his constant companion. It's the same as us, really. We've always been with him since the 1963. So we were just waiting for him to come back. His costume is authentic to the period, which just isn't like the Doctor. This was the first time we see him in his costume, that new costume. And normally he just goes into places and he's wearing this ridiculous outfit, no dress sense. It's completely eye-catching, and he normally draws people to him. That was one of the reasons. But this time he fits in, which reflects the Doctor's state at that point, because he doesn't want to draw attention, he doesn't want to get people involved in his life, so he's fitted in at this point. So yeah, obviously the TARDIS was big on the inside, that was the main special effect. This is it's a classic trait of film, creating a reality that just isn't possible and seeing it on screen. It makes everything seem much more real, having that walking in. George... I can't pronounce his name, but we were learning about him the other day. He was the first guy that really was using film. And we saw him change those, I can't remember what he changed, but he changed telescopes into stores. And he loved the idea that film was like a magic trick, and you can do things that you wouldn't be able to do in reality, and it makes people temporarily believe in something, even though they know that it's not real, they just like to believe that it's. So he created things that you can't normally do in reality, and obviously Doctor Who does this massively in the shot. You just wouldn't be able to find that anywhere in reality. And that was special because obviously after over 40 years we'd never seen that. We were just made to believe that this cut from an exterior shell to an interior room was just, it was big on the inside, but now here it is, a visual reference, it is big on the inside. Yes, that's it for that bit. The sound. It's quiet for the most part, up until obviously the big moment, but it reflects the Doctor's current attitude towards life. It's obviously, Matt Smith's Doctor's energetic, he's this big, bouncy character, and that was reflected always with the sort of show's music, especially since Matt Smith came in, they composed this incredible soundtrack that was just, it was always over-exaggerated, but at this point there was nothing, it was completely dead, it was completely opposite of what Matt Smith was all about. But then obviously when he's turns on the lights, all of a sudden there's this booming soundtrack, which is the classic Matt Smith theme tune. And yeah, so he's back. It's like the Doctor rebooting, which is So the TARDIS has mechanical electronic sounds, which makes it seem more alive, because if it was just a still set with no sounds, it would just be like a set. But obviously they refer to TARDIS being alive a lot, so they show that for sound, weird, recognisable sounds, warp sounds, just, yeah. But also, it kind of reflects on the Doctor rebooting again, because you have the clicking and then the charger, you can hear sounds, though it's whirling around. Yeah, the door creaking was interesting, because the first Maximus TARDIS, they got rid of that. He wasn't old anymore. Well, he was, but that was part of his Doctor. And now that the door is creepy again, it shows that he's kind of being worn down again. And also maybe how long has he been alone? If that door hasn't been open, if that part of the Doctor's life hasn't been open for that long, and all of a sudden the door's creaking because it's old, how long has he been alone? The Doctor lied, so maybe he's been alone for hundreds of years up there. Who knows? Also felt like we were going something dark, something secret, something mysterious. Starting from a third-person perspective, Doctor Who's like that. We sometimes feel like a companion, but most of the time we know things that the companions don't. But then, at this point, we literally get taken from a third-person perspective straight down from a person's point of view, as though we're walking into the TARDIS. So it felt like we were a companion, immersing us in the story, which was very exciting considering that it was the first time we see this interior. It's very human, which adds to the realism of the scene, makes that special effect seem even more real. Yeah, paying a camera angle like that and an effect like that was interesting. It just makes it seem that more real. And it was probably, it's the best way to experience it for us from a human perspective, rather from a film perspective. So, there's mostly no editing, so it adds to the point of view idea. Adds to the idea of it's a magic trick. It's an illusion. Makes it seem that more believable. Yeah, it doesn't feel like a film, more like reality. Okay, yeah, Matt Smith's Doctor is energetic. He was essentially running away from himself, which some people don't understand, because he was young, but he was old, so he was running away from the fact that he was old, running away from the fact of all his loss, his grief, the fact he committed genocide. So that was Matt Smith's character. He was the opposite of what you'd expect him to be. But then, at this point, he isn't in the editing. And that was shown through the editing, through the massive jump cuts and camera angles. But now, if it just runs straight through, it's completely the opposite of Matt Smith again. And it was a very down-to-earth feel. It was like, we're being serious now. Which was interesting, because if you do a shot where it's kind of saying, this is a bit more serious, it's a bit more realistic, and you pair that with a special effect that you can't find in reality, all of a sudden it's saying, if you're being realistic, then that special effect is realistic. It's a weird combination. All of a sudden it feels quite real. So in the past, we've just cut from there's a few exceptions, but we just cut from an exterior shot to an interior shot. And we believe that it is bigger on the inside. It relies on our belief. But no, now it walks straight in. So, yeah. There we go. Done.
Why did you choose to end the clip halfway through Jurassic Park? Because I know it's not the same feel as you go along, but it's just, why did you think that was the best one?
I thought there was a lot of content in that, just that shot. If you watch behind the scenes, they did a lot of explanation just on that one shot. So I thought there was definitely enough content there.
When you say there's not a lot of editing, would you not consider loads of stuff they put in there in terms of special effects editing?
Of course. No,
when you get
at
the beginning, they're on a big cloud.
I mean,
I'm pretty sure they didn't go on a big cloud.
When I say editing, I mean cuts.
Yeah.
Yeah. Not obviously, yeah. There was a lot of CGI, which...
In that scene, you could almost say that Maximus' character regenerated.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. He was more what you'd expect him to be at that point, but then he becomes that bouncy character again. Although, you can still tell there's a long way to go. He still has quite a sad smile when he turns around. He's still not quite what he's a very mysterious man.
Okay, anybody got another question? Are we done? Yeah, thanks, Mark.
Okay.
Looking good.